USA Radio News with Jason Wirt.
Please continue to pray for Jacob and the other victims of this horrible, senseless crime.
A relative of Jacob Hall, a six-year-old boy fighting for his life after a teen opened fire at an elementary school in South Carolina. The Greenville News reported that he sustained a major brain injury from a loss of blood and that Jacob is still on life support. Jacob was reportedly hit in the leg by the gunfire. Investigators with the National Transportation Safety Board looking into yesterday's deadly accident in Hoboken, New Jersey, say they're unable to get to the front train to look at the video footage because the building collapsed upon it.
There is a lot of destruction. It's very difficult to get in. That's why we're so concerned about safety. I mean, you can actually see that the canopy or the roof has collapsed over that section, and it's resting on top of the controlling car.
Investigators say the engineer of the train has tested negative for both drugs and alcohol. USA Radio News. Shimon Peres, one of the men who helped found the modern nation of Israel, was laid to rest today. Here's more from correspondent Chris Barnes.
He was a great man of Israel.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says the fact that leaders from 70 nations turned out to remember Shimon Peres at a huge funeral today
is a testament to his optimism, his quest for peace, his love of Israel.
At the funeral held at Israel's National Cemetery in Jerusalem, President Obama also spoke.
May God bless his memory, and may God bless this country and this world that he loved so dearly.
Peres died a couple of days ago at 93, several weeks after he suffered a stroke. I'm Chris Barnes.
Tulsa police officer Betty Shelby pleading not guilty to the fatal shooting of a black man. Shelby entered the plea this morning to first-degree manslaughter in the shooting death of Terrence Crutcher 2 weeks ago. The case has sparked protests and riots around the country. More details at usaradio.com. I'm Jason Wirt. The protests continue in California over the shooting of an illegal immigrant who pointed a vaping device at police in a way that looked like a gun. Here's Jason Campidonia.
Dozens of officers from in and around San Diego County swarmed a corner in El Cajon last night as protesters blocked off traffic where Alfred Alongo was shot and killed by officers. This is the third night of demonstrations, but it was the first time officers outnumbered the protesters. Officers took a hard line and warned the crowd they might be arrested. Several protesters even tried dispersing the crowd. That didn't work, and officers in riot gear started shooting tear gas and pepper balls into the crowd. After a moment of chaos, two men were arrested. Protesters want the footage of officers shooting Alongo released. Jason Campidonia, San Diego.
Donald Trump encouraging people to take a close look at a woman Hillary Clinton is holding up as an example. Here's Joe Gomez.
This morning, Donald Trump launched a new series of attacks against Alicia Machado, a former Miss Universe who claimed Trump called her Miss Piggy because of some weight gain. Machado was thrust into the public spotlight on Monday when Hillary Clinton mentioned her during the debate.
He called this woman Miss Piggy. Then he called her Miss Housekeeping because she was Latina.
This morning, Trump took to Twitter encouraging his followers to check out Machado's, quote, sex tape and asked if Crooked Hillary helped Machado become a citizen so she could use her in the debate. Joe Gomez, Washington.
USA Radio News.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Frank Vetro Show. Always an adventure here. WLINY.com, America's number one internet radio station, Long Island, New York, the world. Anyway, oh my God, I don't know what's going on. A lot of scrambling. I don't even know how to say it because I'm so inept social media wise. Tweet, is that what it is? So Meerkat is gone. Would you believe that doesn't even mean much to me? All I know is that Eric was getting everybody hooked up to something else. But for future notice, so I don't even know what we're on right now, except I know that you could go to the WLINY.com website, anybody listening in, and spread the word. Just go directly to WLINY.com. That's all you need to do. No panic. We're also up on Periscope, by the way, but who cares what network goes out? Once again, I'm going to tell you this right now. All you guys have to do, we're not, WLINY.com is never going out. We're always up and running. So just go there. When all else fails, you want to hear the show or any other one of the great shows that we have, any of the other great shows, I should say, WLINY.com. That's all you need to know. No muss, no fuss. Don't worry about it. You don't worry about nothing. I take care of everything. Remember that movie, everybody? All right. So, rainy day here in New York. Rainy day. Let me get some business out of the way. I don't mean in commercials, not just yet at least. But so we have a new show we signed on, and I can't wait for you guys to listen to us. Rebecca Coco Kennedy. She has a show called The Politics of Love. Yeah, that is exactly, it is exactly what it sounds like. The Politics of Love. It is coming. It's not on yet. It's going to come up around mid-October. She's going to start. She already signed up, but she's going to prep a little bit. I don't know why she has to. She really doesn't need to, but she's really fine-tuning the show, perfecting everything. It was on air not too long ago, actually. She took a bit of a hiatus on another network and has join the ranks of WLINY. Proud to have her aboard. It's going to be a great, well, it is a great show, and you guys will see also that it is a great show. I cannot wait for you to listen to her. She's talking about sex. Let's face it, everybody. That's what she's talking about. Dating, the dating game and sex. And it's no holds barred. She doesn't clean it up. She doesn't have to. And it's a unique show. It's good. You're going to like it. Anyway, The Politics of Love. Another announcement. Hey, you guys heard of the Red Light Robin Hood, right? Everybody's favorite. I don't mean it like I say it, but you know how you guys know him as the lawbreaker. He's up on charges now. They're looking to throw him in jail. He's running for state senate right here in New York, and he's got a fundraiser. You know, if you go to California Pizza, if you're in the area, if you're in Long Island, if you're in Suffolk County, you go to Lake Grove, right here, right down the road from the studio. Now that I think about it. On October 17th, that's a Monday, I believe, October 17th, all day long, you go to California Pizza, a pretty good percentage of your bill, they will donate to the Red Light Robin Hood's campaign. So if you're tired of the red light cameras giving you tickets, causing accidents, being implemented unconstitutionally, if you like what the Red Light Robin Hood's all about, risking his own life, perhaps jail time for us, for you. Go down to California Pizza. You got to eat that day. You have to eat. You might as well eat there. And California Pizza is going to be nice enough to donate. I want to say off the top of my head, I could be wrong, 20%, maybe more. Pretty good percentage of your bill will go towards the Red Light Robin Hood's campaign. Because, you know, he's going against the big dogs. And he's going to need some cash to succeed in this election. He'll be running. He's doing it for you guys. So October 17th, the Red Light Robin Hood. All right. Yeah, so what's going on? The big debate today, everybody. The big debate, keyword debate, you know, Trump v. Hillary, is should Trump air out the dirty laundry? Should he bring up Bill Clinton? Should he mention Bill Clinton's past? Who really cares? What is Bill Clinton screwing around all these women, treating them badly, have to do with Hillary's ability to run the Oval Office? I don't know. I'm going to touch on that a little bit later. So you hang on right here. Hang on tight. We're going to get through some other stuff first. And in the second segment, after our first commercial break, we're going to touch on that. I got to be honest with you. I don't give a good goddamn what Bill Clinton did. I didn't care in the 90s what he was doing in the White House. I don't care if Colin Powell was banging Hillary in the Oval Office. It doesn't matter to me. And I'm going to get more into more of that later. So, we'll get into more of that later. Should Bill Clinton's history with women be mentioned by Trump? Should he go there or should he just stick to policy, the issues? So we'll touch on that a little bit later. Two Long Island schools were named in a national blue ribbon schools. Allegedly, that means they're real good schools. The schools, which you people listening around the United States won't even know what I've never heard of them, but you know what? They have money. And that's the ticket. They have money. You will never see a poor school district on some national blue ribbon list. No money, no blue ribbon. You need money. That's all there is to it, all right? You're not going to see my school, Longwood, where I graduated from. No schools in the center of Long Island make the blue ribbon list. Going down, you get the, for those of you not on Long Island, you go down to center Long Island, forget about it. You go to the North Shores or the South Shores, on the water. That's where you have your money. Of course, I grew up in the center of Long Island. On the shores, you have your money, and that's where the schools are. There's no secret. It's not the teachers. It's not the principals. Come on. Let's face it. It's where the money's at. That's what it's all about. When has it not been about the money, right? When has it not been about the money? Here's an interesting, you know, a lot of you guys know I talk about Thomas Spoder a lot and the corruption on Long Island, right? So here's an interesting story before I go national here. There's going to be a Navy SEAL museum scheduled to be built. Nice. It's in honor of Michael Murphy. He's a native of Long Island. He fought in the he went to Afghanistan, and he died serving his country. Navy SEAL. And an 11,000 square foot museum is being built in his honor. But it reminds me, so it's a Navy SEAL museum. Great idea. Great. No complaints, right? But let me tell you guys what's also on Long Island. And somehow, some way, it gets linked back to Mr. Corruption himself, Thomas Spoder. My buddy Tommy. The Long Island Sports Hall of Fame. People that associated roots in Long Island, their sports, if they were good at sports, whatever it is, good enough to make the Long Island Sports Hall of Fame. Here's the problem. Taxpayer money funded it, right, in part. It's at the Long Island MacArthur Airport where I used to run a radio show, actually. We pay for it here on Long Island. I pay for it, but I can't get into the museum. And nobody else can either. In order to get into the museum, you have to have a plane ticket. Unless you're traveling on an airplane, you can't get in. But I pay for it. That doesn't matter. You have a flight ticket? You going somewhere? You traveling around the United States? No. Well, you can't get into the museum. So I hope this museum... I mean, can you believe what goes on in Long Island, everybody? Do you believe this? Can't get into the museum unless you have a plane ticket. I got to spend $400 in order to go into the museum. Forget that I pay for it already. You believe what goes on in Long Island? And it was started by some corrupt individuals. Corrupt. I mean corrupt individuals. Unbelievable. All right. New York homelessness hit 60,000. 60,000. No matter what the mayor says, don't listen to him. New York City, 60,000 people homeless. That doesn't count everybody sleeping in Penn Station and on the streets of the city. It's getting near like the 3,000 mark. All right. Homeless up. Homicides up all over the United States, actually. You name it. But we're on the right track. Trump is wrong, though. We're not bleak. We're not in dire straits. He's wrong to paint that picture, isn't he? Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Hey, Sean and everybody else in California, what the hell is going on in San Francisco? I know California's a big state. Voters will consider a tax on soft drinks now. Sweetened cola. The sports drinks, I guess Gatorade, Powerade, and whatnot. Canned teas. All the drinks with the, quote-unquote, empty calories. They're going to tax them. It's going to be a penny per ounce. Another gimmick. Another way they can make money. You think they really care about your health? You really think they... So now you're going to vote on that? Vote it down, everybody. Vote it down. Man, I want to drink I don't even drink soda, but if I want to, you're going to tax me on that? You got to be kidding me. Now, again, next thing they're going to tax you on, you eat a cheese doodle? It's a tax. Luxury tax. You ate a cheese doodle. You want to get Carvel? Are you out of your mind? You have to take out a second mortgage. We're watching you. And if you eat something bad, I really care about you. You really think the government cares about you in California? Oh, we really care about you. This is what we call tough love. In other words, we ran California into the ground. Basically, we filed bankruptcy. Our state is bankrupt. Okay? So now we're going to pretend we care about you guys. Don't drink that, because if you do, tough love. We're going to make you pay extra. We're going to tax you on that. We need to get you to stop. We care. We don't care. We need your money because we suck as politicians. The lawmakers, the rule makers, the people running things, we can't get out of our own way. Tax you on soft drinks. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Hey, no show Monday, guys. No show Monday. Before I forget, there will be no Frank. I'll be back Wednesday. No Frank Vetro show Monday. Hey, what's up with the FBI? What's up with the FBI here? I just don't get it. I really don't get it. James Comey. So he's in front of the House Judiciary Committee for a couple of days, right? And he tells them, listen, if you want to question our decision not to prosecute Hillary, that's one thing. But you can't question our process and how we investigate it. You know, don't call us weasels. We're not weasels. We did a good investigation. We did the investigation the way you want it to be done. So the House Judiciary Committee is sitting there and they're like, well, why were the witnesses granted immunity? And he explains the process. And then they're like, well, we're questioning your interpretation of what the felony statute is. Like, why didn't you have her up on felony charges? Seemed to fit in. Extremely reckless, Hillary, with the emails. Comey says, James Comey, director of the FBI, says the case wasn't even close. It wasn't even a close call. And no one else would have been prosecuted for the same acts. Meanwhile, just about every attorney under the sun said otherwise. You know how many prosecutors? Do you know how many prosecutors said otherwise? This baffles me. He did the investigation the way we wanted it done. His conclusions were that Hillary Clinton was a freaking liar. And she mishandled classified information. Highly classified. And lied about it. Extremely careless. And then he's going to say it wasn't a close call? I don't understand. I mean, this guy Comey, man, he's really baffling me. I don't know how he is at work right now. Can't somebody suspend him? Say, listen, you're suspended. Somebody needs to say, you know what, Mr. Comey? We've had enough out of your mouth. You're telling me you did the investigation the complete right way, which is fine, and then you can't. So the perfect investigation came up with the perfect results to put somebody up on charges, and you didn't. I think we've heard enough, whereas we need to investigate James Comey, in all honesty. That's what I think. I mean, this is off the charts, out of control. Back here in Suffolk County, the police department is providing sensitivity training, everybody. Sensitivity training. This way the officers are equipped to deal with and recognize disabilities, people with disabilities such as autism, okay? They're going to offer an 8-hour training, 8 hours. They're going to deal with 12 different disorders in 8 hours so that perhaps they will, when they're interacting with the public, they can maybe sniff out and understand why somebody's not complying immediately. Maybe they have a disability, you know what I'm saying? A disorder. Okay, no problem. But that's my point. The other day, I went on some type of rant on this show about how police officers need more education. That's what I said. Some people said I was a little rough on them. But look at this. This is what I said. See, school teachers, they have to take courses like how to recognize child abuse, things like that. And they take various courses with regard to students with disabilities and whatnot, especially if you're a special education teacher. Forget it. You go to years of school, master's degree regarding it. But cops, they don't have to do anything. I think they should be more educated at on different levels. Not just let's go to the police academy and now we're good. No, there's different things you have to do, such as this. You're dealing with the public. You should have to recognize things like this. Individuals that are disabled, that have disorders. You should recognize that and react accordingly. Teachers where I work have to recognize my students and their needs and their disorders and their disability. They have to. And they react accordingly when the kid isn't behaving or behaving as a quote-unquote normal person. Without a person who doesn't have the disorder, who may react what we want to see as normal. So this really just feeds into my whole monologue the other day. Police need more training. They need more education. They do. I'm not against them. With all the controversy going around the United States, I am on the police officer's side. I happen to think that people are just being anti-authority just for the sake of being anti-authority, but for no reason, because they don't want to listen to police officers. Stop walking. Stop walking. Stop, stop, and they keep going. What the hell you keep going for? Freaking stop walking. Alrighty. So don't get me wrong. I'm on your side, police force. But I think you need more education. Just all around education. I need you to be better thinkers, generally speaking. I need you to raise the bar. I need every profession to raise the bar. It's that time. And recognize certain things. You need more training. Alright. So Michelle Obama was out campaigning for Hillary Clinton, and she was in Philadelphia, and she says that America needs an adult in the White House, referring to Trump, of course. The presidency doesn't change who you are. It reveals who you are. Oh, yeah, we know all that. We know that real clear. We learned that, Michelle. We learned that, Miss Obama, Miss First Lady. We learned that the hard way, because nobody really heard of President Obama. He was like a rookie senator, what have you, out of Chicago. Didn't do anything yet, really, not politically. Then he went on Oprah and everybody started to learn his name. Then everybody started to learn his name. But then when he got to the White House, after he fooled everybody, then we started to see what he was all about. It's about nothing. He's corrupt. I think, you think I'm crazy. Call me nuts. Fine. I think he should be up on charges. Let's just go all the way to the top. I really believe he should be up on charges. When we saw who he was, when we finally learned the real Obama, he was in the White House. The White House did bring out who he always was. So you're right, Miss Obama. The White House reveals who you are, and you guys were revealed. Somehow you fooled America, and they voted for you twice. Just goes to show you. Twice. Damn. Unbelievable. She goes, if a candidate is erratic and threatening, a candidate traffics in prejudice, fear, and lies on the campaign trail. If a candidate thinks not paying taxes make you smart or that it's good business when people lose their homes. If a candidate regularly and flippantly makes cruel and insulting comments. Oh, he's so mean, Trump. He's so mean. He's calling people names. What a bad man. Oh, God. Comments about women, about how we look, how we act. Well, sadly, that's who that candidate really is. Oh, my God. There go the ninjas. I've been saying it for months, everybody. They want to throw smoke bombs. They want to distract you from the real issues. They want to distract Trump from the real issues. Pay no attention. And we will get to more on that later when we get back from commercial break. First, I'm going to go to a commercial break. And we're going to learn a little bit about this Harlequin. We're going to pay some bills. We got some sponsors here, everybody. You're listening to the Frank Vetro Show right here on WLINY.com. Check us out. Well, you can check us out right on the website, WLINY.com. I'm going to start referring to everybody. Just go to, we're on a lot of apps. All right, we're on a ton of apps. But if you just go to our website, I'm just going to steer everybody. Man, I own a website. This is our website. Why don't we just steer everybody there? WLINY.com. Anyway, I'm Frank Retro. I'm on every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 4:30 Eastern Standard Time. All right, we'll be back right after this.
Hey guys, it's Eric from Cop and Calamity in the Morning. Let me talk to you for just a second about Harlequin Capital Corp. See, when you're shopping for a mortgage for either buying a home or refinancing your home, you don't want to deal with a company that's going to string you along day after day only to find out when it's all the dust settles and you hit that closing table that what they promise is not what's there. Nope, that's not Harlequin Capital Corp. See, they have integrity in closing. They know the mortgage business. They know their products, and they know what they have to do to ensure that you get the best mortgage at the best rate and a rate you can afford. They know their stuff. Harlequin Capital Corp. 888-815-1120. 888-815-1120. One more time. 888-815-1120. Call Harlequin Capital Corp. for all of your mortgage and refinancing needs today. They know their business. And that's what you need to know. Harlequin Capital Corp. 888-815-1120. 888-815-1120. Give them a call today.
Dad, you look a little stressed. What's wrong?
That's okay, Martin. You probably wouldn't understand.
Come on, Dad. Try me.
Daddy got himself in a little bit of a mess, and I have to hire a lawyer.
Is that all?
You make it sound so simple.
But it is simple, Dad.
How is it so simple, Martin?
WhenYouNeedALawyer.com. It's the fast and easy way to get the legal help you need fast.
How'd you get to be so smart?
I'm not answering any questions without my lawyer.
And just where are you going to get a lawyer?
It's not rocket science, Dad. WhenYouNeedALawyer.com.
It's that simple, huh?
Yup, that's simple.
WhenYouNeedALawyer.com?
WhenYouNeedALawyer.com.
An extraordinary story of a real-life David versus Goliath is told as Frank Vetro, a young charismatic principal on the rise of the educational system, has his life taken away like you won't believe. In Standing on Principle, Vetro provides a first-hand account in real time of an innocent man in the justice system and details the tedious struggle to clear his name. You will never hear another story like it. It broadens from local themes right here on Long Island to global themes of social political importance. Learn the struggles of Frank Vetro as a career was lost, as well as employment and his home. For more information about the book, go to frankvetro.com.
You know I like my chicken fried, cold beer on a Friday night, a pair of jeans that fit just right, and a radio up. I like to see the sunrise, see the love in my woman's eyes, feel the touch of a precious child, no mother's love. Well, I was raised up beneath the shade of a Georgia pine, and that's home, you know, where sweet tea began pine.
Cold beer on a Friday night, that's what I'll be drinking. I like my beer.
It's not much to talk about.
Got my jeans on too.
But it's filled with love that's grown in southern ground. And a little bit of chicken fried. Cold beer on a Friday night. A pair of jeans that fit just right. And a radio. Oh, I like to see sunrise. See the love in my woman's eyes. Feel the touch of a precious child. No mother's love.
Welcome back to Frank Vetro's show. Cold beer, Friday night. Pair of jeans fit just right. That pretty much describes me after this show. I can tell you that right now. All right, everybody. Welcome back. WLINY.com. All right. Trump versus Clinton. Everybody's debating. Everybody's getting their 2 cents in. Don't fall for the trap. Don't take the bait. The Democrats, they want you to get away from the issues. They're trying to poke you. They're trying to get you. Because once you talk about the issues, they say, she's done. She'll never win. But if you start bringing up dirt and talking about that, you still might win, Trump. That's what they say. But she has a chance. Stay on the issues. and then she won't win. She has no chance. Well, here's my take on that. All right. First of all, Hillary was in Iowa. Here's the difference. Before I get to that even, I keep stringing you along. You see how I do that? And I really never get to it. I'll get to it. Hillary was in Iowa, right? And she says, I'm going to keep talking about my agenda. She didn't say what her agenda was. She said Trump could talk about whatever he wants. When it was mentioned that, what if he talks about Bill, her husband? I'm going to stick to my agenda. She didn't say what her agenda was. Let me tell you what her agenda was, is. It's getting him sidetracked, getting him to sling dirt instead of the issues. Because everybody expects him, because then they're going to call him a bully. It may backfire, right? She spoke, by the way, in front of 200 people. Hundreds, they said. Hundreds. That was the crowd. Well, Trump was in New Hampshire when she was in Iowa. Here is the difference. Trump was in front of 2,000 people. You see the difference? Hillary is just blah. She can't take large crowds. It's always a more intimate setting. Almost hand-selected. She can't take the big crowds. And she's so really blah. No leadership qualities, no energy, she just stirs zero excitement. So she's in front of a few hundred people, and Trump was in front of 2,000 people. You see the difference, everybody? And that's how it's been from day one. The excitement. He really does bring excitement. He's enthusiasm, a hope for the future. Whether you think he's going to be good or not. And Hillary's just... We're going to have 4 years of that. Like, man, there's just no excitement. I have nothing. I'm not thrilled about where we're at. That's what you're going to do. You're going to wake up to that all the time, right? That's what you want to wake up to. Quinnipiac poll had him winning 44-37. All right? The poll was in favor. You know how I feel about polls, and I hate polls, so let me get that right out there. I'm not trying to be a hypocrite here. Just throwing it out there that last month, Clinton was up 42 in the Quinnipiac poll, and now she's down. She was down this morning by 7. Okay? She's in Florida today. How about that Michelle Obama commercial? So Michelle Obama, I mean, are we as Americans that stupid? Is our memory that short-term where Michelle Obama is out campaigning for Hillary? And it's a great commercial that Trump's campaign is running out with Michelle Obama in the 2008 election, where she says something along the lines, I don't know the exact quote, where Hillary can't take care of her personal house. What is she referring to? Bill Clinton and all that stuff? How can she take care of the White House? She can't take care of her personal house. How can she take care of the White House? Whatever the quote is, I don't know the exact quote. But that's what the general theme was. And it's exactly right. So they did it back then. Why has it changed now? All of a sudden, Michelle Obama's going to campaign. Now Hillary can take care of the White House? Is that what you're telling me? Well, Michelle Obama, what convinced you of that? The way she handled the Benghazi situation? What convinced you of that? The way she handled the Benghazi situation? What convinced you? All of her accomplishments? What were they? In the past 8 years, when you said there's no way she can handle the White House because she can't even handle her personal home, what in the past 8 years turned your mind around? Complete 180. What did it? Please tell me. I mean, somebody can learn things in 8 years. Somebody can right the ship in 8 years. Absolutely. I just would like to know what it was. I know a lot of negative things that happened in the past 8 years. It's just off the charts, unbelievable. So, here's the thing. It's not that Trump can't talk about Bill Clinton. And by the way, you know, people saying, who cares about Bill Clinton? 100% right. Who cares? It's not Bill Clinton. What does Bill Clinton's, you know, affairs and what he did with women have to do with Hillary's ability to run the White House? That's right. In fact, like I said before, man, if Hillary was having sex all over the place, I wouldn't hold that against her as far as running the White House. I don't care. I don't care about somebody's personal life. It's not that. It's that Hillary covered for him, and she was supposed to be a defender. Women need to be heard. Women need to be believed, right? She said that. But she's a hypocrite. Look what she did to these women. It's not what Bill did. It's what she did in defense of Bill. That's it. Do you understand? You saw everybody out there that's saying, what's wrong with Trump? Who really gives a crap? That's so stupid. And all the Democrats. You're right. Nobody cares about Bill. I don't care. Let me tell you something. I wrote a book, everybody who's listening, Standing on Principle. And in my book, I do this whole little thing about how we should never, ever judge people and take their careers away from some personal thing. Nobody's perfect. And whoever you think is some kind of hero or role model, get rid of it. They're human beings and they make mistakes. And because they screw up in their personal life, don't make that be preventative of them holding an office or whatever else. Listen, I don't care what people, I don't care. Listen, if my boss has an affair, doesn't mean he shouldn't be my boss. That's his personal, like, you listen, man, it doesn't, what does that have to do with his ability to do the job? When I was a high school principal, a public school principal, I was arrested. And I was all over the media. And I got fired. And they said I lacked moral, I couldn't do the job. That's what they said. Are you kidding me? And they started to judge me. And it came out that Frank Vetrel was banging all these women, basically, having all these affairs. I was innocent, by the way. Not of all the affairs, of the crime I was convicted of. Let's just set the record straight. But guess what? I was like, and not only my own words, but the words of the community by which I was principal. I was the greatest thing around. I was doing good things. And that's not me saying this. I just, if you read it, and it's well documented, how everybody felt about me and my accomplishments as a principal, as a young principal on the rise, had nothing. I was a single guy. And I had, in my personal life, I was messing around with a lot of women, adult women, consenting adults. But that all came out. And who cares? Going on dates here and there. So what? It never affected my job. But they tried to link the two and I was labeled. So believe me when I tell you, I don't give a good goddamn what Bill Clinton was doing with women on the side. So listen, if I was married to Hillary Clinton, I'd do the same thing. You think I'd enjoy looking over to my right or left shoulder when I wake up in the morning and seeing that? And listening to that voice? Oh my God. I don't care about Bill Clinton, what he did. It's what Hillary did. You bring that up when they start throwing things around. Again, you don't harp on it. This is what you do, Mr. Trump. You know, I met a lot of people and they're dissatisfied with you as a businessman and, you know, all the people you screwed over. So then Trump could just, you know, real briefly. Well, you know, I met a lot of women that you ruined, you know, because of what your husband did. Remember those women? And go, name a few women. 10 seconds. And then say, now listen, people say a lot of things about me. And you know, I wasn't a politician. I was my personal business. I was looking out for that business. Never did anything illegal. I found loopholes. I hired people to do, you know, to find loopholes. And I got around a few things legally. And that was for my business. And now I'm going to put all my effort into running the United States and putting the United States first, just like I I put my business first. So let's get back to the issues, all right? Because, you know, people are going to say things, and that's not really me. And I was never a politician, so I was in private business looking out after the best interests of my family and my business like everybody else does out there. Now I'm going to be a politician, and the people that don't like me, I'm sure they're going to describe me as an evil man, but let's just stick to the issues right now, Hillary. And then blast her with some issues. And every time she brings up some negative, well, your bankruptcies. Use the same tact, the same thing. And then get back to her, you know, briefly. He can still briefly touch on her negatives and briefly hint at some skin. The emails. Why not go to the emails? You didn't file your taxes. Well, you lost a lot of emails. Da 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 da. 10 seconds. Calmly. Don't. And then say, now can we get back to the issues? Because they do want Donald Trump sidetracked. So I'm going to stick with what I said the other day. Slam her, but spring the trap like he could have done in that debate when she was, you know, she was throwing these things out at him and the bankruptcies and the people that he did supposedly bad business with and his tax returns and you name it. It's like he could have turned everything around. How he, you know, the housing industry and how he took advantage and he liked when there was a real estate recession. Turn it all around. Briefly spend 10 seconds calmly. It's easily explainable. And then say, you know, that's my private business. I was a private businessman. I wasn't a politician. Now let's get back to the issues. And then twist it on her. Spring the trap and hit on her negatives. But what's your excuse for the Benghazi? You were serving the public. I wasn't. So let's go to Benghazi now and touch on it. Then say, now can we get back to some issues here and get it with the issues? And if I was him, listen, this economy is in shambles. Jobs. Like, here's a man that knows the numbers. He's got a $10 billion empire that he built. He knows. She doesn't. If I was him, I'd be promising the world jobs. Keep sticking on that. Jobs. Get on the issues. The economy. You know she doesn't. She's wrong. And people will love you. Touch briefly. You want to counterpunch when she jabs at you? Just a little 10 seconds. That's it. Politely. Then say, now let's get back to the issues. Issues. Let her answer the question, what have you done? That was a good take. The last 30 years. What have you done, Hillary, for the last 30 years? Nothing. She can't answer that. Bring it out. Expose her. Don't let her off the hook. Expose her for what she's done and hasn't done. And stay on the issue. Let her try to get you sidetracked. Let them all get you sidetracked. What should happen is, and Rudy Giuliani has done a fine job of being his bulldog in defense. Everybody around him should be taking that angle. Everybody around him should be bringing up Bill Clinton, perhaps. And let the main gist, let Donald focus, hammer home jobs. They're going to get him sidetracked or try to. Stay disciplined, dude. Not that you can't never mention it. You want to counterpunch? Do it. Brief. Please be brief. And spring the trap, like I said the other day. My last show. Bring it up. I mean, don't bring it up, but mention it. Mention it after she tries something. 10 seconds and get back to it. Get her on the issue. She can't. She can't deal with it. That's why she's going to bring it up. That's why she's going to get you sidetracked with her smug little face. And that's it. That's what I would do if I was Donald Trump. Issues, baby. She cannot win. I got roped into, last night, I got into a little friendly conversation with my childhood friend, Craig. And he caught me. He said, he made me bet. So we bet a steak dinner. For those of you not in New York, the wager was to, the loser has to take the other one out to dinner at Peter Luger's Steakhouse. It's a upper echelon, I suppose, steakhouse here in New York. Two of them, one in Great Neck, one in Brooklyn, and I believe the one in Brooklyn is where John Gotti used to dine at frequently, among many other people, by the way, not just him. And so I mentioned that on social media today. He called me because I should have said, I should have made the bet that Donald Trump will win the popular vote. He's going to get more votes. He's going to get more votes. I just don't trust the Electoral College. That's a whole different situation. So I didn't, though, so I'll stick to the bet, but I should have said let's stick with the Electoral College. Hey, Monday the 17th, Monday, October 17th, for those of you in the area, in the Long Island area, go to Lake Grove, New York, all day. Go to the California Pizza Oven. California Pizza Oven. Stephen Root, the Red Light Robin Hood, is running for New York Senate, State Senate, and he's going against some heavy hitters. His campaign can use some money. You got to eat on Monday, right? You have to eat. You might as well just go to the California Pizza Oven. You might as well. Just do it. And a pretty good, a large percentage of that bill, the California Pizza Oven is generous enough to donate a large percentage, over 20, at least 20%. I'd say at least 20% towards Stephen Root's campaign. He could use every dime that you get. He's fighting for you guys. It's the Red Light Robin Hood. He's fighting for you. The least you could do is when you eat, just go there. It's not coming out of your pocket. You're paying for the meal. And the California Pizza Oven is going to take a percentage of what you already paid and distribute it to his campaign. So it's not really affecting you. You have to eat anyway. Monday the 17th, all day long. When you're hungry, go to California Pizza Oven. All right? That's Monday the 17th. All right. We're going to go to a quick commercial break, and we're going to end the show on a good note. After the commercials, after I pay some bills, some of my sponsors, we'll end with a nice little story. Listen to the Frank Vetro Show. Every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 4:30 Eastern Standard Time. Thanks for hopping on the V-Train, everybody. You can catch me on Facebook, on Twitter, at Frank Vetro. Go to my website, frankvetro.com. I'm in the middle of – I'm actually talking, by the way, guys, with a man from California. Got some big things in the works regarding my book, Standing on Principle, and you know, all the corruption that I'm fighting. We got something in the works. And it's the infant stages, but got a big, big, big plan in the works. And I'll keep you guys abreast of the situation, of course. All right, paying some bills. Back after this.
Hey guys, it's Eric from Cop and Calamity in the Morning. Let me talk to you for just a second about Harlequin Capital Corp. See, when you're shopping for a mortgage for either buying a home or refinancing your home, you don't want to deal with a company that's going to string you along day after day only to find out when it's all the dust settles and you hit that closing table that what they promise is not what's there. Nope, that's not Harlequin Capital Corp. See, they have integrity in closing. They know the mortgage business. They know their products, and they know what they have to do to ensure that you get the best mortgage at the best rate and a rate you can afford. They know their stuff. Harlequin Capital Corp. 888-815-1120. 888-815-1120. One more time. 888-815-1120. Call Harlequin Capital Corp. for all of your mortgage and refinancing needs today. They know their business. And that's what you need to know. Harlequin Capital Corp. 888-815-1120. 888-815-1120. Give them a call today.
Dad, you look a little stressed. What's wrong?
That's okay, Martin. You probably wouldn't understand.
Come on, Dad. Try me.
Daddy got himself in a little bit of a mess, and I have to hire a lawyer.
Is that all?
You make it sound so simple.
But it is simple, Dad.
How is it so simple, Martin?
WhenYouNeedALawyer.com. It's the fast and easy way to get the legal help you need fast.
How'd you get to be so smart?
I'm not answering any questions without my lawyer.
And just where are you going to get a lawyer?
It's not rocket science, Dad. WhenYouNeedALawyer.com.
It's that simple, huh?
Yup, that's simple.
WhenYouNeedALawyer.com?
WhenYouNeedALawyer.com.
An extraordinary story of a real-life David versus Goliath is told as Frank Vetro, a young charismatic principal on the rise of the educational system, has his life taken away like you won't believe. In Standing on Principle, Vetro provides a first-hand account in real time of an innocent man in the justice system and details the tedious struggle to clear his name. You will never hear another story like it. It broadens from local themes right here on Long Island to global themes of social political importance. Learn the struggles of Frank Vetro as a career was lost, as well as employment and his home. For more information about the book, go to frankvetro.com.
So many thoughts to sit and ponder about love, love, and lack of, and this emptiness in my heart. Do you want to be wild and free still? Too young to be over the hill, should try to grow on, but who knows where to start? So I just sit right here and have another beer in Mexico. Do my best to waste another day.
Enough! Back to the Frank Vetrell Show. I'm running out of time. I can't be listening to Kenny Chesney. I love that song, though. All right. Some of these comments. I like how you're thinking, Sean. Do they turn your life into a movie? You can be an extra. You can. Sherry, did you just say he could be the cop that gave me the baloney? Remember that scene out of my book? Move the fuck around. Go around, he told me. The correctional officer told me that. I want to break his neck. Are you out there, correctional officer from Riverhead Jail, cursing at me to go around the pole to get the bologna sandwich that I didn't freaking want? Cursing at me like I've been there before, like I'm supposed to know, just totally belittling me. If I see this guy in a dark alley, in a light alley, if I see this guy at church, I don't care where I see him, I'm going to break your legs. I'm going to kick in your hole. All right, now I'm getting excited over here. All right, I'm sorry. Anyway, we've got a story here. Before we get to a nice little story to end the show, and once again, I want to remind everybody, The Politics of Love, a show coming on in mid-October with a woman by the name of Rebecca Kennedy. Okay? She's the hostess, and it's gonna knock your socks off. In fact, it might knock all your clothes off. I don't even want to know what you people are going to be doing if you listen to this show on a Friday night. It's about sex, everybody. No holds barred. Dating, marriage, affairs, who wants what, who likes what. That's it, man. Dr. Ruth, Delilah, bang their heads together, and you get The Politics of Love. All right. Here's a weird thing. Some months ago, it's taken over the New York, and it's a national story about Karina Vetrano. Can't even say the name. She was found dead. Okay. She was strangled in New York. Strangled, beaten pretty badly, actually. Sexually assaulted. There's DNA that they found. They've been trying to find the killer. Matching all the DNA and all the criminal samples, right? And they can't match the DNA. They cannot find who did this. So here's what's weird about the case now. A couple months later, they're searching everywhere, high and low. They found this guy. Okay? Matt, I don't even want to say his name, 47-year-old man, though, was found naked in the mud of Spring Creek Park. Okay, he's found naked. And they said he's not a suspect in this Vetrano case, but investigators took a careful look at him because the statements, here's what's weird about this. So he was found naked in a park. And he made statements when officers tried to extricate him from the soggy ground. So as they're taking him out of the soggy dirt, grass, mud, naked, this is what he said. The father did it, and I have nothing to do with it. What? The father did it, and I have nothing to do with it. He was yelling at the police. That's weird. So they took his DNA, and they said it was unclear if the man was referring to if his rent was referring to the murder or not. But He was arrested on public lewdness charges, trespassing, and they're looking for the result. They're waiting for the results of his DNA. He voluntarily gave up his DNA sample. You know, no problem, but that's pretty weird. He's naked, and he says, the father did it. I have nothing to do with it. Weird. That's just weird. If nothing else, the dude's a weirdo. All right? All right, check this out, everybody. Let's end on a nice story. I think it's a nice... Well, it's a tragic story. But it's a. I want your mindset to be of peace and helping others. I help people every day, as you know, the people that know me. And I want you to get that mindset. So there's this... I want to get these guys on my show, actually. I got to get Eric on that. There's this couple. Sonia Sonny Jacobs and Peter Pringle. Sonia Sonny Jacobs. First, the tragedy. Okay? In 1980, Peter Pringle was convicted of capital murder and robbery after a police officer claimed to have heard a confession from Pringle. Peter Pringle. He was sentenced to 15 years in prison and death. During his years in prison, he practiced yoga and meditation. That's something I did. And he also learned the law, something I did. I have some stuff in common with him, and helped other inmates with their cases. He prepared his case, and his conviction was overturned in 1995. That's not the story, though. He then helped Sonia Jacobs. She uses a wheelchair to the podium, so he helps this woman to a podium. Sonia Jacobs explains how her prior conviction, okay, before that, she says, you know, she used to be a daughter, a wife, a mother. That's like right out of my book, man. These guys have a lot in common with me. Her and her former husband, she's not married to him anymore, were both convicted of capital murder, and they were also put on death row. She explains the way her husband's execution malfunctioned and he was set on fire. That is not my story. Jacobs, she was placed in solitary confinement for 5 years. She was allowed to take a 15-minute walk 2 days a week and was prohibited from having any human contact. Her sentence was changed, and she spent 12 years with the general prison population. Her conviction was overturned in 1992. So separate lives right now. Separate lives. Then she explained her troubles, how hard it was to reunite with her children. They were 9 years and 10 months old at the time of her conviction. And she started to establish, she's trying to establish better relationships with her family. Then she invites her husband back to the podium. Her husband, Peter Pringle, by the way. And this is where they start to tell everybody all the good they do. And they start to talk about forgiving the people. I don't know if I could, I mean, they want to forgive the people. That I'd like to ask them about that, how they forgive the people. And they started this project. They wanted it to be like the Innocence Project. It's called the Sunny Center. It's a charity organization for wrongfully incarcerated individuals to help them when they get out, to help them adjust. It's tough to adjust. We've interviewed a few people on my show now in the last month, and we always ask them, you know, how was it to adjust after spending 10, 12, 15, 20 years in prison for something you didn't do? Then you get out. How do you get back on track? You know, the world changed. And that's what they do. That's what this charity does. They help people when they transition from being let out of prison to lead a normal life as much as they can lead a normal life. And they say that we wanted to help, to do something to help other people go through what we've gone through. That's what her husband Peter Pringle said. So separate, you know, they you know, their cases were separate, both wrongfully convicted, then they met up and got married, and both tragic stories. Then they came together and like, hey, what are we going to do to help other people? They created this foundation, the Sunny Center, it's called. And at the end of their, they do this little presentation where they encourage people to forgive those that have hurt them. Imagine that. Forgive those that have hurt them. I mean, these people went through hell, both of them. And they claim that those individuals did, quote, those individuals did the best they can do at that point in time. I have to tell you, I think I'm a pretty good guy. I don't think I could do that. I really don't think I could sit here and say those individuals that did me dirty did the best they can do. I think they could have done a lot better. But anyway, I would love to. I'm going to try to get these guys on the show. I like you guys. You know, they authored a book. It's called Time After Time, and it's due out. It might be out now, or it's due out by the end of this year at least. Called Time After Time, and you should go to their website. It's thesunnycenter.com. The Sunny Center, just like it sounds. Thesunnycenter.com. I'm going to try to get these, at least one of them, hopefully both, on the show, because interesting story. Two tragedies. All right, both in prison for murder, a crime they didn't commit, one on death row. One of them's husband was on fire because when he got fried, it malfunctioned. Both wrongfully convicted. Now they go around the world, not just the United States or not just a country, around the world doing seminars and preaching about doing good for people and forgiveness. Really a tremendous story, and we should leave on that note. I have a four-day weekend coming up, everybody. I'm off on Monday, but I promise you, I'll be here Tuesday night standing on principle with Phil Jacino. That's 8 o'clock Tuesday night right here on WLINY.com. Just stick with me. You know, keep in touch on the social media. You'll know all about the shows. Go to the website, WLINY.com. Other than that, you guys have a great weekend. Corruption's always there, and you want to know something? I'm on the wall fighting for you. I will sniff out that corruption, and I will take them down. It's what I do. You have any issues? You have any problems? Keep it up. Keep contacting me. I'll take care of them. I promise you. If I can, I will help you out. Can't help everybody. If I can, I'll help you out. All right? Keep emailing me. There's a contact page on my website, frankvetro.com. You keep doing what you're doing, and I promise I'll keep doing what I'm doing. All right, guys. Peace and hair grease. Thanks for hopping on the V-Train. Next stop is justice, and I'm taking you there. Have a good weekend.